Good day to you from Chem Help ASAP. Let's go through a sometimes confusing topic, the laboratory notebook. This video needs to open with a disclaimer. If you are keeping a laboratory notebook, then follow the instructions of your instructor, your research advisor, or your boss in your job. This video shares my opinions on how to keep a notebook, but there are many different styles that people use. Furthermore, many people advocate for electronic notebooks, which have their own features and demands. So you have been warned. Heed the instructions of those who are in authority over you. With that out of the way, let's jump into the lab notebook. I'll often connect synthetic laboratory work to cooking, and I'll continue that line of thinking here. A recipe that you see online or in a magazine might have a picture of the final food dish. Next will be a list of ingredients. The instructions or procedure will follow. At the end is normally a statement about what you will get, something like serves 4 to 6 adults. A laboratory notebook actually follows this exact model. Here is the top of the first page from one of my lab notebook procedures. Here are some features. You need a date somewhere. The first page is numbered. In fact, all your pages should be numbered before you start writing in your notebook. Numbering pages is important and allows reference to the experiment based on its page number. Some people emphasize other features like a title or statement of purpose. I'm not so keen on those ideas. The next big thing in a scheme that shows is what shows is the reaction. This is the reaction scheme. Recipes show a picture of food. A lab notebook shows a picture of a reaction. Just show starting materials, reagents, and the product. Do not show mechanisms. As a side note, I like to put the yield here once I know it, over to the right of the scheme, but it's not required. After the picture of food, you have the ingredients for a recipe, and a list of the reagents in a lab notebook should follow the reaction scheme. This is sometimes called a table of reagents. The table should include some kind of name of each reagent. We have 3 reagents, and the molecular weight of the reagent. The next column is the mass or volume of the reagent. Reagents are either weighed on a balance, mass, or measured by volume. Either is fine, but make sure you put your units of measure next to each value in the column. The next column is for the number of moles or millimoles used. I tend to use millimoles because I don't normally do mole scale reactions. The final column is for equivalents. Equivalence gets into the limiting reagent for the reaction. Let's look up at the scheme. All 3 reagents react in a 1:1:1 ratio. Notice in the millimole column that we did not use the reagents in a 1:1 ratio. We used way more of the butanediol than anything else. Benzyl chloride was our limiting reagent with the smallest number of millimoles. The number of equivalents for the limiting reagent is automatically given a value of 1.0. The other equivalents are proportional to the limiting reagent. So the number of equivalents for sodium hydride is calculated as 170 divided by 140. That gives us 1.21. Butanediol is calculated as 229 over 140, or 1.64. If you want to, you can think of the 1.0 for benzyl chloride as being calculated as 140 over 140, or 1.0. I like to leave space in the margin, and I've kind of written all over it, for other information, and that might include information like molarity or density, other factors, values that might be needed to calculate the number of millimoles of a reagent based on its mass or volume. Note that we are looking at a notebook page for a reaction that has been completed. Before you start a reaction, you complete the top of the notebook page, the date, the reaction scheme, and the entries for the reagent table. Do not fill in the amount of the reagents until you actually dispense the reagent. Too often, students will just copy the recommended amount from a laboratory procedure into their table, even if they use a different amount. At best, that is sloppy. At worst, that is fraud. Make sure you write down what you did, not just what was recommended in the handout. Great, now let's look at the procedure. Here is the bottom half of the previous page. Note that I like to write in prose. I just write a bunch of sentences to describe what I did. Some people like to use bullet points. Other people like a two-column format with kind of an action, observation style. All of these are fine, in my opinion. Your job in keeping a lab notebook is to make sure that you record enough information so that someone else could repeat the experiment and get a similar result to yours. That's a bit vague, but that's the point of keeping a lab notebook. Think back to recipes again. Recipes don't tell you everything. They don't tell you to get the eggs out of the refrigerator and remove them from an egg carton. Recipes just say, add two eggs. They assume you know what you are doing. You can do the same with a lab procedure. Give enough detail so that someone else can repeat your work. When in doubt, it's better to include more information, not less. However, do not just copy the lab procedure. Instead, write down what you did. If the procedure says to wait 10 minutes, but you waited 15, be sure to record 15 minutes in your procedure. Let's look at what I recorded. Mostly what I did, but also some observations. On the second line, I noted that the reaction bubbled. If you were repeating this reaction and saw bubbles, you would probably wonder if that should happen. Reactions don't always bubble. If it isn't written in the procedure, you might assume that it shouldn't happen, and therefore wonder if you had done something wrong. Other features like color changes, or just as importantly, lack of color if something is colorless, and precipitations, solids precipitated. These are vital to record. Let's go to the next page. There isn't a lot more to the procedure. Note that the previous sentence only needed one more word. The next sentence starts with a new date. So the previous page was dated 7/15, July 15th. Apparently, I took a day off before I finished this reaction and picked it back up on 7/17, July 17th. If the date changes, you need to make a note of that to that effect in your procedure. We also see that the final yield of this reaction was 88%. That's a crude yield because I don't note doing a purification. Why didn't I do a purification? Well, the next line says that the NMR looked okay. Apparently good enough that it didn't feel that the product needed to be purified. I did notice a couple impurities, some ether, and a bit of another side product. How would I find this NMR spectrum? It's not in the lab notebook. The previous page was page number 40. That's the page for this reaction. So the NMR would be connected to this page in my notebook. My initials are EPS. This notebook is my seventh. I would have named this NMR file 7EPS40-CR. That's the seventh notebook for me, EPS, page 40, and the crude product from this reaction. Make sure you name data files in a concise, unambiguous manner so you can easily find the files at a later time. Okay, let's finish with some common mistakes that I see students make. I've already mentioned most of these. First, do not recopy your lab notebook. For some reason, students think their notebook should be beautiful. That's not true. Your notebook is a record of what you have done. It should be legible, but it doesn't need to be perfect. It's a working document. Second, record what you did when you did it. Don't wait to write things down. If you just weighed something on the balance, then immediately record that mass in your notebook. Third, write down what you did, you being the key word. Don't copy the handout procedure. This is a record of what you did, not what the procedure says. Finally, I want to add one more thing that I didn't think of until I recorded this slide. This is a bit of a personal preference. Write in black, ballpoint. I'm so excited I can't even write properly. Black ballpoint pen. Black ballpoint pen only. Not blue, not purple, not felt tip or gel pen, not pencil. Black ballpoint pen only. In many settings, the lab notebook is considered to be a legal document. Therefore, you should treat it as one and use black ballpoint pen. I'm not going to fool myself into thinking that a lab notebook from a teaching lab is truly a legal document. But if you go into the workplace and record data in pencil, somebody might have some very stern words for you. All right, that is the wonderful world of lab notebooks. Just write down what you did in enough detail that someone else can repeat it, and you will be fine. I hope this video was helpful for you. Please subscribe, like, or leave a comment. Take care.